which is my first time, and especially to Alfredo for his friendliness all this time. Well, here I'm going to talk about some work I've done in Luxembourg with Ronan Fleming, who you have probably met. He's sitting here in front in case you haven't. This picture is from Luxembourg. It's a quite nice city. It is also a country. This is one question that many people ask me. It is a nice city to spend, for example, one day. Probably I wouldn't recommend it to spend more than one day there, because if you walk for more than one day, you get out of the country. So this is the outline of my talk. So the problem I'm going to talk about is related to monotonicity, and it arises in biochemical networks, which is what Ronan is mainly interested in, and it's also what the research is, one of the big areas in the research center I'm working on. It's a research center of biomedicine specialized on Parkinson's disease and Alzheimer's. So the first part would be to describe these biochemical networks. The second part will be to introduce a new monotonicity property. You think that there are enough? No, there is a new one. And the third one is to show you some algorithms using this property. So this is what we call a reversible elementary reaction, and these are the type of reactions that we are interested in. So this is would be the most typical one, the most basic one. If you get two molecules of hydrogen plus one molecule of oxygen, you get water. And this is very easy to, well, this is also a reversible reaction. So you can go, for example, from this way to this way. If you mix hydrogen and oxygen, you put a spark, and then you get water. You will also get explosion. But so be careful when doing it. I was actually going to do this experiment here, so because you can also decompose water in hydrogen and oxygen. For example, you put a battery, and you put two wires, and then you put in the water some catalyst. Is it called catalyst? Like, for example, salt or bicarbonate. And then you will start seeing bubbles coming from the wires. And from one of the wires, there will be hydrogen coming. And from the other one, there will be oxygen. And you will see that you get the double amount of bubbles from one side than from the other. And yeah, and be careful. Don't make it a big amount, because you can get the explosions with the hydrogen. So you can write also this reversible elementary reaction in this way. So two molecules of hydrogen plus one of oxygen, you get two molecules of water. Here we will denote by C1, C2, and C3 the molecular species concentration. So this will be a vector. In this case, it will be a vector in R3. And what is called as the net reaction rate is the rate at which the chemical reaction occurs. So this is more or less, roughly speaking, like the speed at which the reaction occurs. And it's depending on these parameters here that are called kinetic parameters. So these parameters depend, for example, on the temperatures or on the conditions at which the experiment or the reaction occurs. So for example, temperature or pressure or many things. So of course, depending on these conditions, the experiment will occur at faster or slower speed. So based on these parameters here, so in these numbers here, we can define what they are called stoichiometric matrices. This is the forward stoichiometric matrix, and this is the reverse stoichiometric matrix. How are they defined? It's very simple. So here we have two molecules of hydrogen. So each row of these matrices denotes a molecule or a metabolite. And each column denotes one reaction. So here we only have one reaction, so we only have one column. So it means that two molecules of hydrogen, the first metabolite, plus one of the oxygen, gives rise to two molecules of water. So it's pretty simple. And based on that, you can define a differential equation for the time evolution of the molecular species. So based on this, on the speed at which the reaction occurs, and then multiplying it by the stoichiometric matrices. So in general, things are not so easy. We are not going to deal with water, hydrogen, and oxygen. So we will have many molecules and many reactions. So in general, we will have n molecular species and n reversible elementary reactions. F and R will denote again the forward and reverse stoichiometric matrices. As I told you, the columns will be the reactions and the rows will be the metabolites. And we will assume constant non-negative kinetic parameters, so these parameters that define the speed at which the reaction occurs. C again will be the vector of molecular species concentration. And the dynamical equation can be defined in this way. So this is exactly the same that we had before, but here I'm using exponential notation and exponential and logarithms. And this is taken component-wise. So actually what we have here is just a product of things to the power of the defined by the stoichiometric matrices. So it's exactly the same that we had before. So we are interested in steady states of these dynamical equations. So for us, this right-hand side is going to be very important because we want to find steady states and analyze them. So for we can, for example, transform this right-hand side into a logarithmic scale. So just denoting, instead of taking C, we take X equal to the logarithm of C, we take the logarithm of the parameters, and then we get this function here. That it's a bit nicer, and at least we have better properties about this function. And as I told you, we are interested in steady states of this function. So what we want to do is to find zeros of this function. So let me show you a simple biochemical network. So this is one with three molecules and three reactions. Here, in order to make it easier, I assume that the kinetic parameters are equal all to one, so they disappear. They don't appear here. They don't appear here in this right-hand side. And the forward and reverse reactions, in this case, they are defined by these matrices. So I colored here in each of these reactions. So the first column means that you use one molecule of A in order to produce one molecule of B, so it corresponds to this one, and so on. So then, if we put all this in the expression of f of x, we get this function here. And we are interested in finding the zeros of this function. In this case, it's very simple. We can see that the zeros of this function, they are all the points such that the components are equal. But this is just a toy example to show you. In this example and others, so what we conjecture, actually it was Ronan who found this by testing. He has many examples coming from biology and reconstruction models of many different type of things, E. coli, even the human metabolism, there is a reconstruction. So he tested that it seems that this condition here is true. And what I mean by it seems that it's true is that you can test it for millions of millions and leave your computer, and you cannot find a point where this is not true. So that's a bit funny, because if you look at this, it's quite similar to what you get for monotonicity. But for example, if you try to see if the function is monotone, it's not monotone. And in fact, this is a good example. That's the reason why we chose it, because this function is not monotone. And we can prove that this inequality is true. So this was a problem for us, because we wanted to solve this type of functions of finding steady states for this type of function. And if you don't have monotonicity, so what can you use in order to solve these problems? So Ronan tried many things, and then the main idea was like, this should be useful for something. So, and actually when Ronan asked me about that, I've never seen it before. I asked John Borwin, he didn't see it before. I think I asked Nicolas Hadjisavas, or Ronan did, and he haven't seen it before. So we thought, okay, let's study this property. And this is what we started doing it. So in order to study it, what we are going to use is, well, this is the definition of a monotone function. You all know about it. And this is the definition of strongly monotone. So what we did was, instead of studying this property here, the one involving the gradient of the function, what we did was to define a property that holds even if the function is not differentiable. And this is what we call duplomonotone function. So the definition looks quite strange, but it's not so strange. So it's what actually what you get if you take just the definition of a monotone function and you replace, instead of taking y, you take x minus tau f of x, and you put it there, and then what you actually get is this inequality here. And what is the purpose of that, of doing that? What we are going to do is we're going to use this thing in an algorithm as the next point. And this is going to allow us to prove convergence. And the same thing, you can do it here in the strong duplomonotonicity case. So if you put here the y, instead of putting y, you put x minus tau f of x, you get exactly the same definition. So of course, it is clear that, oh, before I forget that, the story about the name. So you know the Duplo from Lego, right? So the Ronan was thinking about a name to put at that, and well, the first thing that comes into your view is like here, instead of like in monotonicity, you are using the function once, right? But here is like you are using twice the function. So it was like using the double amount of times the function, and it was related to monotonicity. And actually, most of the names are taken, the quasi-monotone, pseudo-monotone, everything was taken. And at that time, when he was thinking about that, he saw his kid, he was playing with the Lego bricks. And then I think he thought, OK, this would be a nice name, Duplo, because Duplo means double. Actually, these bricks were designed. These are the red ones are the original Lego bricks, but they created ones that they were double sized because this would, in this case, the kids, it's harder for them to swallow and get suffocated with this brick. So I hope this would have the same effect with the monotonicity you don't get. So anyhow, monotonicity versus duplomonotonicity. Okay, as I told you, it's clear that monotonicity implies duplomonotonicity, but is there any duplomonotone function? Okay, the first thing I tried was just to, the easiest you can do is to consider a linear function. So f of x is equal to ax. You know that the mapping f is monotone if and only if the symmetric part of a is positive semi-definite. What about duplomonotone? You just need to write the definition, so the definition we had before, and then it's very simple to compute that this is equal to this part here. And this has to be true whenever 0 less or equal than tau and less or equal than tau bar. The reason why we are asking for some upper bound is for algorithmical reasons, because we want to be sure that at some point you have this property for sure, because otherwise the step length would, you could have the case that where the step length approach to 0, and we want to guarantee that this property holds. Okay, you will see it later in the algorithm. So therefore, you have that the function f is duplomonotone if and only if the symmetric part of this matrix here is positive semi-definite. So this is the main difference. And for example, let's take the easiest example. If we take this mapping with A equal to this matrix here, the symmetric part is this matrix, which is not positive semi-definite, while the symmetric part of A transpose AX squared is this matrix here, which is positive semi-definite. So this function here is duplomonotone, but it's not monotone. And in fact, F is strongly duplomonotone with modulus sigma equal to 2. So the modulus is the smallest constant such that is, sorry, the biggest constant such that is strongly duplomonotone. It's exactly the same that for strongly monotonicity. So we have this relationship here, and this arrow doesn't hold. And of course, every time you have a backwards arrow that it doesn't hold, you will lose something. There are some drawbacks. So the first one is that you know that a strictly monotone function has at most one zero. And this is not the case for even for a strongly duplomonotone function. So the example I showed you before has a zero at every point 0x2. So that's bad, but that's not too bad. OK. The main problem I think about this property is that if you have a function that is monotone, f plus alpha I is strongly monotone. But this is not true for duplomonotonicity. Even more duplomonotonicity is not even preserved under addition. So here I have one example. If you consider this function f of x equal to ax with this matrix, this is duplomonotone. It's very easy to see because a transpose ax squared is just zero. And then if you choose some perturbation alpha and you define g of x equal to a plus alpha I times x, what you get is that the eigenvalues of this new matrix B transpose Bx square of the symmetric part are these two numbers here. And if alpha is in 0, 1 over 2, we have that one of the eigenvalues is negative. And therefore, this is not duplomonotone for any alpha in 0, 1 over 2. So it can be very easily destroyed, the property. So that's something bad. This is, well, as you recall, this is what inspired us to define the property. And it turns out that if you have a function that is differentiable, then if f is duplomonotone, you have this inequality here. And if f is strongly duplomonotone, you have this inequality here. So by now, I'm pretty sure that you are wondering, is really useful for anything, or this is just another property to write a paper about? It turns out that it's useful because as a simple corollary of the previous proposition, that actually it's very easy to prove, we have that if your function is differentiable and strongly duplomonotone, then for all x, either f of x is equal to 0 or minus f of x provides a descent direction for the merit function square of the norm of f. So therefore, we can use minus f of x as a direction and use that to find a zero of the square of the norm, so a steady state, which is what we wanted. And in fact, you don't even need the function to be differentiable because strong duplomonotonicity is equivalent to this property here. And this property is what actually we are going to use in our algorithm. Why? Because as you can see here in the right-hand side, we have this term. If you have that the function is Lipschitz, this part here will be some constant multiplied by the square norm of f of x. So it will be added to here, and you will have that the next point is less or equal than some constant multiplied by the previous. And this is what gives you the convergence. So it's quite simple. So I will show you three derivative-free algorithms based on this idea. In order to make things simpler, I will assume that your function is strongly duplomonotone and Lipschitz, even though we don't need Lipschitz, with some constant L greater than 0. And as I told you, we aim to find some 0 of this function. So the first algorithm is really, really easy to program. The only thing that you do is you set the step lambda constant equal to the minimum between these constants. And while your norm is greater than some epsilon, so the accuracy that you want to obtain, you iterate in this one. You take the next point equal to the previous one minus lambda times f of xk. And you iterate until you find a solution. And it is not difficult to prove that this algorithm generates a sequence such that it satisfies this inequality here. And therefore, f of xk is linearly convergent to 0. And any accumulation point of the sequence is a 0 of f. But OK, what happens if we don't know the Lipschitz constant, which is what happens many times? Then we can use a backtracking technique. And this is actually what we have here in this algorithm. This is actually the same. As you can see, the next step is defined in the same way. But what we have here is just a backtracking technique and some sort of Armijo rule that guarantees the decrease. And we can prove that this algorithm generates a sequence that is also linearly convergent to 0 with this rate. And of course, this rate is going to depend on the strong duplomonotonicity constant and on the Lipschitz constant, even though the Lipschitz constant is not used here. Okay, but probably, as you are thinking right now, the strong duplomonotonicity constant is hard to obtain as well, right? So what happens if we don't know the strong duplomonotonicity constant nor the Lipschitz constant? Then we can use some sort of double backtracking technique, which is what we have in this algorithm. So it's again very simple, even though it looks more involved. So we take again the same direction, minus f of xk. And then what we do is to try to achieve this Armijo rule. And if we don't get it, what we do is to decrease the parameter alpha such that we get this inequality. And again, we can prove that there exists a sequence, sorry, not there exists, that every sequence generated by this algorithm is linearly convergent to zero, so f of xk will be linearly convergent to zero, and any accumulation point will be a zero. And of course, again, we get that the rate will depend on the duplomonotonicity constant and on L that I cannot see. Yeah, L is here. So let's go back to the original three molecules and three reactions example. So what happens in this case? As I told you, this is a duplomonotone, but it is not strongly duplomonotone. So what happens if we apply the last algorithm I showed you to this example? Does it work? What do you think? It actually does. And we still don't have a proof for that, why it works only with duplomonotonicity, but the algorithm works well. And what I've plotted here is the norm of f of x. So in the x and y axis, you have x1 and x2. I didn't plot x3 because otherwise I would need a four-dimensional thing. And then in the z axis, what I plot is the norm of f of x. And these points here are random points. So I'm taking random points here. And as you can see, all these points are converging to the zero of the function. And they are converging quite well. And this, yeah, this line here is just to show that the square of the norm is not a convex function, as you can see in the level set. And what about the speed of the convergence or the rate of the convergence of the algorithm? We don't know. That's also another open problem in general. If we only have duplomonotonicity, we don't know how it works. So what I'm plotting here is these examples are real examples from biochemical networks, from reconstructions. I just took 9 different biochemical networks, some of them with 100 variables and reactions, and others with even 1,000 variables and reactions. And what I'm plotting here in green is the steepest descent method, which you know is quite slow. But at least here, well, the blue one is what we obtain if we applied the duplomonotonicity. So just taking minus f of x is better than the steepest descent direction. And of course, it's way much faster because you don't need any information on the derivative or anything else. Yes, you just take the previous point and you take minus this direction. And yeah, and at least I haven't found an example yet where steepest descent worked faster than the duplomonotonicity. But this is also open. And in general, we don't even know under which conditions of F and R the function that we obtain is duplomonotone. But every time we test it, it's duplomonotone. You can leave it for 4 days and it's duplomonotone. And just 2 final pictures. So this is to show you the growing interest in biochemical reconstructions in the previous years. So this is the number of metabolic reconstructions available since 1999, and this is 2013. So right now there are available 145, probably more, models, including, as I told you, the human metabolism, which is the one I'm showing in this next slide. So this is the most comprehensive metabolic model available. So here RONAN did a fisheye view in order to show the reactions. So this is the kind of models that we want to study. what do we want to do? Okay, even if we have the algorithm to find zeros of these functions, this is not our real purpose. So what we want to do, this is also another open problem, is we would like to minimize, for example, a convex function subject to this type of constraints, f of x equal to zero. So we would like to see how to use this duplomonotonicity in order to find, to minimize an appropriate function, for example, one of the metabolites, to see what which is the lower bound of one of the metabolites subject to these constraints, and we still don't know how to use it. So if you are interested in this type of things, please contact us. So this is the web page of the of our group in the University of Luxembourg. There is an opening, so RONAN has money for PhD students. If you you know some student that would like to work in optimization with the view of having something applied, because this is very important here. You have this function. This is a different viewpoint, because you have this function and this is what you have to deal with. You cannot impose an extra condition. Okay, let's assume that our set is compact. No, you have to deal with that. So it's a different viewpoint. This is what you have, and deal with that. And also, he will have some money for some postdocs. So there will be an opening soon for some postdocs. So feel free to contact us. And yeah, these are the main references of this talk. You can get, so the paper has been accepted in Optimization Letters. You can download it from my website. Actually, the slides are already there. So if you're interested, go to my webpage and you can download everything from there. And yeah, I think that's it. Thank you for your attention.
Question, remarks, suggestions?